Good afternoon, everybody. How are you today? Thank you for coming. It's my pleasure to present our distinguished guest, Ms. Barbara Ericson. Ms. Ericson is a senior research scientist at Georgia Tech and a part-time Ph.D. student in human-centered computing. She works for the Institute of Computing Education at the College of Computing at Georgia Tech, where she's trying to improve the quality and the quantity of secondary computing teachers in Georgia and all across the United States. She actively fosters collaboration between all teachers of computer science everywhere, and she generously sends out emails on the latest developments in CS education, sharing opportunities for teachers and students to grow and develop in the field. Ms. Ericson has a bachelor's degree and a master's degree in computer science, and she has worked in several research labs, General Motors Research Labs, Bell Communications, and the Institute for Paper Science and Technology. She has also worked with 3D graphics, artificial intelligence, robotics, medical informatics, telecommunications, finite element analysis, object-oriented development, and computer science education. She holds two patents for her work in case-based reasoning, and she and her husband, Dr. Mark Guzdial, were the winners of the 2010 Karl V. Karlstrom Outstanding Computing Educator Award. She was also the winner of the 2012 Richard Newton Educator Award for her efforts to attract more females to computing. So please join me in giving Ms. Barbara Ericson a warm welcome to FIU.
Thank you. Well, I love computer science, and so I'm here to try to tell you what I think is really cool about it and tell you about women have been in computing even from the beginning. I'm going to give you a short history of women in computing. So this is the world's first computer programmer before there were even computers. So she was translating notes about Charles Babbage's analytic engine, and she added notes because she realized how you could use the analytic engine to solve problems, so specifically calculate Bernoulli numbers. And so she wrote the first algorithm in her notes, which became a large treatise that came along with the article. And she was the daughter of Lord Byron. So in fact, her mother, Lord Byron was a poet, if you don't know, and her mother thought that he was crazy. So her mother encouraged her to study math as a way to sort of keep the craziness away. But so this was an odd thing at the time that she was allowed to study a lot of math, but she had a lot of friends that were very good mathematicians, like De Morgan. And she was excellent at it. So she was our world first computer programmer. This is the first Harvard computer lab. Back then, computer was not a machine. It was a title, someone who computes. So this was the Harvard computers, women. They hired women in the late 1800s to do astronomy observations and process astronomy data. And they made a lot of discoveries, which, of course, weren't always credited to them as women. They were only paid half the male wage. So they hired a whole bunch of them because they were cheaper, but they were also very good and detail-oriented. These were the first programmers of the ENIAC. So back when World War II started, they were starting work on computers, but before they had computers, they needed to create these ballistic tables. So if I'm firing a missile, I need to know, okay, what's the weather like? What's the humidity? Where do I want to throw, you know, where, how do I want to do it? And so you have to calculate, do a whole bunch of calculations to figure out how to aim the guns in order to hit a target. So they created these tables. They hired women mathematicians from colleges to become computers, that was their job description, who would do these calculations. And some of those women went on to become the first programmers when their first computers were created. So a lot of the list was secret because it was during World War II, so this only came out a little bit after it. And there's a nice documentary about this you might want to see about the Secret Rosies. So this is Admiral Grace Hopper. She was one of the first programmers of the Harvard Mark I computer, and she's one of the persons who created a compiler, first of all, in 1952. She helped define a programming language called COBOL, which was used a lot in business. And she became a rear admiral eventually, so she's really cool. She had a lot of great sayings, like ships in port are safe, but that's not what ships are for, and it's better to ask forgiveness than get permission. So she was a really interesting character. And there's a big convention or conference every year, the Grace Hopper Celebration of Women in Computing, that's named after her. So women have been around in computing for a long time, but I'm gonna tell you now about a little bit about my journey in computing. So when I was in high school, about your age, I always loved animals. I've always had a whole menagerie of animals. I had chameleons and cats and dogs, and I loved horses, and so I thought I'd be a vet. But the only school, I'm from Michigan, that has a veterinary school is Michigan State, and I didn't get a scholarship to Michigan State, so I was like, oh, well, maybe I won't be a vet. I also was in debate in high school and loved arguing, and so I thought maybe I'll be a lawyer. My best friend was my debate partner. She wanted to be a lawyer. But I got a scholarship to Wayne State University in downtown Detroit, and they don't have a vet school. And I said, okay, well, I'll major in political science so I can go to law school down the road. But I was at a commuter school, like here. There's a lot of people that commute here. So we would all drive in during the day and then drive home, and a lot of us had jobs in the evening. And I was driving in with people who had been at school for 5-6 years because they changed majors partway through. And I thought, well, that doesn't sound like a good plan. So if I decide not to go to law school, a degree in political science doesn't really buy you a whole lot. So I said, I better double major. What should I double major with? Well, I had taken a programming class in high school, this was a long time ago, back when we had no computers actually in the classroom. You had to dial up with these modems. And so we used these teletype machines that you see here to connect to a college nearby that had a computer. And so we learned how to program on that. And I thought it was interesting. It was logical, like law, so it was very logical. And we got to solve problems. I like to solve problems. So I said, hey, I'll double major, political science, computer science. Which people used to go, what? That's a very strange double major, political science, computer science. I said, yeah. They said, well, what do they have to do with each other? I said, not a whole lot, except we do writing in both. You write programs in one and you write papers in the other, you know. But I thought that was fun. So eventually I did internships in computer science, trying to decide, well, do I want to go to law school or do I want to do computer science? And I found I liked it. I thought it was an interesting career. And because I was on a scholarship, I actually started taking some master's level courses too while I was an undergrad to say, hey, do I want to go that way or do I want to go to law school? And I took artificial intelligence, which I really liked because computers are stupid. They're really dumb. So we have to try to make them look intelligent. Well, that's kind of interesting, right? What do we mean by intelligence? You know, how do I make something act intelligent that isn't intelligent? Wow, that's really kind of cool. So I really liked artificial intelligence. I took 3D graphics, and I really liked that too. That's very heavily math, but I thought it was really neat to be able to create things, you know, that you can just make up in your brain, right? Just make things up, and you can make them real on a computer screen. Ooh, it's kind of cool. So I took master's level classes and said, yeah, I really like computer science. I think I'll go ahead and graduate, you know, in computer science and go that route. So I got a job at General Motors Research Labs back in, this is 1984, a long time ago. Back then, we didn't walk around with computers. We had great big rooms with computers in them, and they weren't movable. They were giant machines, and they had to be kept cold. So this is the computer room back then. What's one of the things that's interesting about this picture? Oh, actually, can you tell who I am in this picture? Yeah, it's probably not that difficult to see. What's interesting about this picture that maybe you wouldn't see today if you were, yeah.
I think it looks like a pretty
human group. Yeah, we were about 40% female in the mid-80s. So you didn't feel odd to be a woman in computing because there were a lot of women in computing. So it's actually one of the fields that's lost women over the years, which I think is very strange because it's a fun job, interesting job, creative job. So sort of strange that we've lost women. But yeah, we were 40% female. One of my jobs after this, we had 7 females out of 8. We had a token guy. So Bell Communications Research is where I went next in New Jersey. And we did database applications. I actually created a system with touch tone input. This is a touch tone phone for those of you who've never seen one of these things. When my daughter was little, I took her to the doctors and they were doing these pictures and they had a phone like this and they're like, what is that? I said, she won't know what that's a phone. She's never seen something like that. But back then, we had touch-tone input, and we had speech output. So I got to play with speech synthesizers, which was a lot of fun. We used to record all sorts of crazy stuff, have them play things. But in order to create a system that people who repair phones could use. So that was really kind of interesting. I got to follow around a guy who was repairing phones and see what he does in his job, and write software for him. And Bell Communications Research used to send people away for a year to get your master's degree. So they sent me to Michigan, which is where I'm from anyway. But I went to the University of Michigan then, which is a giant place. Our football stadium is huge, which was kind of funny later when I went to Georgia Tech, because it wasn't cold. When I went to a football game at Georgia Tech, it wasn't cold. We're in Michigan, football is in the cold in the summer, in the fall. It's cold already. And Michigan Stadium holds 150,000 people. You know, Georgia Tech Stadium does not. So I walk in and said, okay, where are all the people? This is what I'm used to. So University of Michigan, got my master's degree in computer science, took more artificial intelligence classes, other classes. Then I came, my husband also went and got a Ph.D. in computer science, and he got a job down at Georgia Tech. So we moved down to Atlanta, and I got a job at the Institute of Paper Science and Technology. And this is a weird looking thing is, it turns out that making cars and making paper both are very expensive and very automated in many ways. So when I was working with General Motors Research Labs, when I got back from my master's and worked with them for a while, we were helping people digitize cars. So when they create, when the designers create cars, they sculpt them out of clay. They used to take a full-size steel frame, slap a whole bunch of clay on it, and they had these things, French curves, that they would pull along the clay and create a curve. And what they were really looking at, next time you see a car commercial, notice the car is always moving, and notice what you really see is the way that the light moves along the car. Because that's what the artists who are creating cars care about. And so the room that I was in with the designers had a whole bunch of lights with black lines in between, and what they were really looking at when they were looking at the car was the reflection of those lights on the surface of the car. So they would sculpt it out of clay, they'd put the stuff on that made it look shiny, like paint, but it wasn't really paint, and then they'd sit there, because they couldn't move the car, it's made out of clay. So they would move, try to see how the light moved across the car. So it was really interesting to work with them. With paper science, what I found was interesting with them is that they try to create paper as cheaply as possible, but as well as possible. So they have to figure out, they simulate, what are the paper molecules gonna be like when I come out of this head box which injects the slurry onto this conveyor belt to make paper. And then this conveyor belt goes around and around and around for miles. And if it breaks, it's a lot of money to clean up. So they do a lot of work with computers to do simulations to figure out what's the proper, how much can I put in of this slurry at what rate and how do I position it and all these things in order to figure out what's the optimal way to make this paper. So that's thin, because if I make it too thick, it's expensive, more expensive. So it's thin, but it doesn't break. So I worked with the Institute of Paper Science and Technology on that, creating simulations for head boxes, doing 3D graphics, finite element analysis. And then I had a really interesting project. I never wanted to be a doctor. My mother is a nurse, and she would give us stories at dinner about all the awful things that happened that day, and we'd say, Mom, we're eating. She didn't care, right? So here I was at NCR, which used to be called National Cash Register, but now it just means NCR. And they were doing a national medical bank, which I thought was really interesting. And so they were trying to create software to help emergency room doctors diagnose brain tumors and strokes. So most people know the signs and symptoms of a heart attack. You know, if you ask somebody, oh, somebody's got pain in their chest and maybe radiating down their right arm, which tends to be how guys present, not how women present. Women often just, you know, don't feel good, and so it's harder to diagnose for women. But if you have a stroke or a brain tumor, often you present with weird symptoms like headache. Worst headache of your life is if you have an aneurysm, so a part of your bursts, that's bleeding in your brain, and that starts to kill your brain in a matter of hours. So with strokes, you only have a couple hour window. The other kind of stroke is a blockage stroke where you have some gunk like that clogs up your veins, and if it breaks off and travels to the smaller places in your brain and sticks, it blocks the blood from getting past it. And so that also causes problems. And you have about a couple hour window to try to fix those things. If you're bleeding in the brain, you gotta go in and fix that. If you're blockage, they gotta try to get rid of the blockage to either dissolve it or do something with it. But not all the emergency room doctors recognize the signs or symptoms of a stroke. So if people don't recognize it. So you've got a really bad headache, what do? You go to sleep. You may never wake up. Yeah, so we're trying to write software to help people recognize the signs of a stroke and figure it out quicker so that you get that 2 hour window to fix people so that they're not permanently disabled. Because if you're outside that 2 hour window, they're probably permanently disabled. So that was really interesting work. Got to follow doctors around. They put us in white lab coats and said, it's just easier to pretend you're interns than to say you're computer scientists. So we're wandering around the back parts of the hospital in our white lab coats going, you know, like I'm a doctor. Not really a doctor. Don't ask me to do anything. And then we got to go in brain surgery, which is not really that weird. It's kind of interesting. They pop out a little piece of the skull and they use, the guy, the surgeon is looking, his hands are in your brain and he's looking at a monitor because they project it. I thought, that's kind of interesting, right? Your hands are over here, but you're looking that way, okay. So it's really interesting to be in brain surgery. It's one of the things I like about my job in computer science. You never know where it's going to take you. You know, I'm looking at the lady I work with going, we're in brain surgery. This is kind of cool. We're sitting here in brain surgery. And of course, the doctors are like, first time in brain surgery? Yeah, I don't usually wander off the street and join brain surgery. I don't know why. It never occurred to me to do that. Maybe you guys should try it sometime. But and there was a little girl in there. We're like, who brought their daughter to work day? I mean, you know, in brain surgery. What? What is this? So now, of course, we can't faint because she's all excited and interested and like, well, okay, great. And they're telling us now, safety tip, if you feel faint, faint backwards because we don't want you in the sterile field. This part's sterile, so don't come over here. Okay, good safety tip. We'll faint backwards. So that's one of the really interesting things. Working on that project was really interesting. I learned way more about the brain than I ever wanted to know. You know, it's like I kept saying to myself, I did not want to be a doctor. Why do I? But I had a meeting with like six brain surgeons. And so they're like, why should we talk to you? And I said, well, I've been reading, so I know that acoustic neuroma is misnamed. It should be called vestibular schwannoma because it's a tumor of the vestibular nerve, not of the acoustic nerve. And they went, oh, okay, we'll talk to you. You know, like, oh, okay, good. Because one of the things you have to do in our field is be able to talk to other people. A lot of people use computer science in lots of different fields. And so why should they have to learn our terminology? We should learn a little bit of theirs to help them, you know? So and medicine is one of those open areas where computer science can really help now. Because now most doctors are using electronic patient records, which means the information is digital, which means now computers can reason about it, think about it, use it. So that's really a wide open area. So then, okay, how did I get to where I am now? Well, with this one, I was working on a case-based reasoning system when I was at NCR, and the lady, the queen of case-based reasoning, was at Georgia Tech, and she wanted me to come work with her team, Janet Klaudner. And I said, oh, you know, I'm busy working on this thing, but when it finished up, I went and worked with her for a while. So I did some consulting at Georgia Tech. And then they asked me to teach some courses because I've taught before. I was teaching some continuing ed courses, so I started teaching courses. And then they said, well, we want somebody to be hired to help us train more secondary teachers to teach computer science because they really don't know computer science that well. And I was like, oh, that's kind of be interesting. So I started work as their outreach person, and I started running teacher workshops to teach teachers how to teach computer science. And we, at that time, in Georgia, there's over 400 high schools, but only 44 high schools out of the 400 offered computer science, AP computer science, advanced placement computer science, and less than 400 people were taking it back in 2004. Last year, we had 1,500. Yay, big growth. We had over 101 schools offering it, so that's one of the things I've been doing for years is trying to get more people to teach computer science and to try to teach it in a more interesting way. So when I first started working with teachers, I went and visited some teachers' classrooms, and I visited a teacher. I said, well, who's a good teacher? And somebody said, oh, this woman, she's a really good teacher. So I went, and I was wandering around the class as she was teaching Visual Basic and showing people how to create temperature conversion from Celsius to Fahrenheit, which nobody cared about. Nobody in the classroom was interested in Celsius to Fahrenheit. And so when I wandered the classroom, I found nobody doing what she was doing, nobody paying any attention. And I said, okay, yeah, that's not working. So what's wrong with that, right? We should be teaching people with things they actually find interesting. So you guys are playing in Scratch, right? Scratch is really cool, I love Scratch. You can create stories, you can create animations, you can create music, you can do all sorts of stuff with it. That's much more interesting than Celsius to Fahrenheit. So one of our problems in computer science is we've been using problems that have been existed forever that nobody cares about. Sales tax calculation, one of the students said, don't we know how to calculate sales tax? Why do I have to write a program to calculate sales tax? We know how to do that. Why do I need to do that? So trying to change computer science to be more interesting, because it is interesting. There's lots of interesting things you can do. So my husband and I have written a lot of books on media computation, which is an approach that he created first about, hey, people play with, what do you use your phone for, right? You take pictures, you text people, you work on Twitter or Tumblr or Instagram or, you know, so use it for communication more than calculation. So that's the idea behind media computation, is let's discuss all the computational concepts that you need, but by writing programs that manipulate media. So they play with pictures, play with sound, play with movies, play with text. So we found that to be more engaging for a lot of people. And you get to be creative too. And if your program goes wrong, hey, sometimes it's cool. Well, that wasn't the effect I was going for, but I like it. I'll keep it. So that's a nicer thing. And you can see over time, we got a lot more kids taking AP Computer Science. So Media Computation, those are some of our books. I have a book that's in Chinese that I can't read that I wrote. I think that's kind of interesting. I did go to China. That was kind of cool, really cool trip. I think there's one in Spanish too now, which I haven't seen that one. But we have a bunch of books we wrote about media computation. And then one of the really cool things in my life is West Point adopted our book. West Point believes every officer needs to know what computers can do and can't do. So they adopted our book. So that's me giving a talk to 1,200 cadets, all in their dress whites, giant auditorium. That used to be the riding. Long ago, when West Point was all mounted, this building, it's called the Castle Building. It's right up here. It looks like a castle. It's really kind of cool. So I thought that was really neat that I was giving a lecture in the building where they used to use the horses, where they used to have the horses ride. And I love horses, and I ride horses and jump horses over things. So, but I was giving the castle lecture to the 1,200 cadets who had used our book that semester. So a lot of fun. I got to sit in a class where they were using it and help them out, because I can't sit still and not help. You know, they were trying to do it. I was like, can I help people? I gotta get up and, yeah, okay, good. Went around and helped people. That's always fun for me. So we also create a bunch of programs for students, because teachers are part of the puzzle. And if I help a teacher learn, I can leverage that, right? One teacher reaches hundreds of students a year even, and over 5 years reaches lots of students. But I also have to try the stuff that I'm creating on students to make sure it actually works. You know, it's not research if we know it works, it's not research. We have to test to see if it works, if it's, you know, to do research. So we also run a bunch of computing summer camps. We run camps for fourth grade up through 12th grade. And we experiment on them. I get people to pay me to experiment on their kids. So we, you know, we try out new things. We tried out Scratch when it was first created. We tried out Alice. We tried out a bunch of things. We do pre and post attitude surveys. We do pre and post content knowledge tests to see if they learn anything. And then we say, hey, this worked, that's not working. We created materials for teachers to use so that we could say, yeah, we didn't just make this stuff up and never test it on anybody. We made it up and we tested it on people too to see if it's working. I also did weekend workshops with, summer camps are great, but we didn't get enough women to come. The summer camps are, you get more boys than you get girls. So we also did a lot of weekend workshops with Girl Scouts and Black Girls Code. And then competitions, we created a couple different competitions, one in Alice, one in Scratch, so that we try to get more. And our Scratch competition was majority female, so that was really nice. We have a lending library, because there's a lot of stuff we use in our summer camps that I don't want it to just sit around, it's expensive. So it's not gonna just sit around the rest of the year, so we lend that out to schools, because a lot of times, especially like robot kits are fairly expensive, and schools can't buy enough for everybody in a classroom to use. So we had lots of robot kits that we lent out up to 3 weeks at a time, so everybody in class could use them. That's our lending library. And we did a lot of fun things with kids, like create art. So this is, you know, using robots, but we use robots to make art. So you have markers, and you teach the robot, you know, you build together your robot thing, but then you make it spin, and then you use markers to make your things. And we make little WeDo robots. And we had soccer goalies and ball kickers, and then we team the girls up and have them try to knock goals in and try to protect their goal. And we created apps with App Inventor. This is one of our competition winners 1 year. So Alice is a drag and drop environment like Scratch, but it's 3D instead of 2D, and you can make movies. I love that they use the Taylor Swift music.
Romeo,
know how this ends. It's not good. I like how his arms are right through her. So at Alice, it's pretty easy to do a lot of things, but there's no, it's not a game engine, so there's no detection of collision and things. So right, you can go right through walls, which is what the camera did when it zoomed in, and you can have people's arms right through your arms. And so it's kind of funny in some ways, but it's pretty easy to make stories. And being creative and making a story like that is a lot of computational work, but it's still cool. It's way cooler than Celsius to Fahrenheit. And, you know, a lot more interesting. We had a lot of people for the competitions that would tell their own stories, too. You know, this one woman was talking about a car accident thing that she'd been in, so she did the whole thing in Alice to talk about her car accident. And people did simulations of some current events and things in Alice, so it was really interesting. My current work right now, I am a part-time PhD student in human-centered computing. What does that mean? Human-centered computing? It means we study computer science, but we also study psychology, sociology, so it's really fun. We get to learn all sorts of cool things. We're thinking about the people as well as the computers, okay? So what do the people learn? How do they learn? What do we use? You know, sociology, psychology, a lot of interesting stuff. So I'm really enjoying that. And one of the things I'm working on is electronic books, e-books. Now that books are electronic, they're digital, they don't have to be just static text and pictures. And so now we can make them interactive, and we can make them so that they include, you know, information. You can run programs right in the book. So this is a book at the top where you write a program that manipulates the image, and we actually get rid of all the red in the image, which makes it look very blue-green, which is actually what happens underwater. So if you've ever taken pictures underwater, the water filters out red, which is why it looks blue and green. So you can actually manipulate your pictures to make them look a little better, less blue-green, by putting back in some red, because the water filters it out, so it's kind of neat. And they actually do that when they do like pictures with National Geographic or something where they're taking pictures underwater, they'll do that. So I've also been working on ways to increase diversity in computing. This picture is one of the projects I started, Project Rise Up for CS, which is trying to get more African-Americans to pass advanced placement computer science. So we form small groups with them, and we have undergraduate students lead webinars, extra help sessions, and we do in-person sessions. So I think this was me teaching them sorting. You can see I have toys. I like toys for teaching computer science. So I have a CNC down there. So we use cards, deck of cards. We have CNCs. We do all sorts of fun things. But and then we also have a project for women, trying to get more women to pass AP computer science. So AP Computer Science A is similar to a CS1 at a college level. So if you want to go into computer science, it's a good thing to do well on. So we're trying to get more people doing that. I've been also helping other states broaden participation in computing. I've been helping other states start computing summer camps. We've been trying to get other states, Florida's one of ours, that we were trying to get to do Project Rise Up as well, or Sisters Rise Up. So we think that has a lot of potential. So what do I like about computing? I like that I can create stuff. I'm really not an artist. My sister's the artist in the family. I'm not really artistic, at least with drawing, but I can create stuff when I program. And it's real, you know, it's on the computer screen, people can do stuff with it, and it stays that way, right? Once I write a program and it works, it's like that. It's gonna work forever, it's really cool. So I love that I can create things with computing. I like solving problems. I was always the person who liked to put things together, read instructions, figure out how to put stuff together, you know, that was fun. So I like solving problems. I like being able to help people. It's really fun for me when I'm working with somebody and they go, can the computer do that? Like, yeah, we can do that. Of course, the opposite is also true. People are like, oh, why can't the computer just look at this thing and know? I'm like, yeah, how is that supposed to work? You know, computer vision is another field. You know, how do I take vision and try to get computers to understand what's in the picture? But that's a complicated thing. So when I worked with the designers at General Motors Research Labs, they said, hey, you know what we really want? We want a system that we can tell it how I want the light to look as the car moves, and it'll give me the 3D shape. And I was like, yeah, we can't do that yet. Or I worked with, when we were working in the medical project, we talked to the surgeon who said, you know what I really want? Because he's got his hands in your brain. You really don't want him playing with the keyboard. He says, I want a system that can understand what I'm saying in this noisy environment where they're drilling and things are going beep and be able to look things up for me and just show me as I'm talking. They're like, yeah, we can't do that either. But maybe we will in the future. Maybe you guys will do that. You know, speech understanding has actually come a long way in speech independence. understanding is working real well now for just a few things, for yes, no, numbers. So now you can talk sometimes to recorded things and it'll figure out what you said, but we're not quite there yet. And I love that there's always something new to learn. Computer science has changed so much since I got started. Remember when I started, we didn't carry these things around, you know? So there's more computing power here now than we had in these giant machines that cost millions of dollars. So you have so much power, you know, in these computers to help you learn and think and process that I think that's really where the future is. You know, using the computer, using humans at what humans are good at, using computers at what computers are good at, but being able to draw on the strengths of both. And people who can do that will excel in whatever field they're in, because every field's gonna need use of computers. You already see that. Biology has to have computer science. You can't sequence a human genome without computers. So I'm going to tell you about some other women now, present-day women that are working in computing. Some of these you might have heard of in the news, like Sheryl Sandberg, who's the chief operating officer at Facebook. So she was actually in economics before she became, she actually worked to make Facebook profitable because she figured out, okay, well, somehow we got to make money to keep this company going. So she figured that out, and she's written a book. So she's pretty famous. Marissa Mayer, who was an early employee of Google, so she's got lots of money, now is CEO of Yahoo, but she got a master's from Stanford in artificial intelligence. So she's actually done a lot of interesting stuff. This is one of the ladies at Georgia Tech. So she's actually Cuban-American, and she's the chair of our School of Interactive Computing, and she's an expert on security and privacy issues. So she goes to Washington all the time to testify about security and privacy, because these are big issues. I mean, when you guys were born, from the day you guys were born to the day you die, information about you is digital. And so how do we protect that? You know, identity theft is a big and growing problem. Cybersecurity, cyber attacks. You may have heard in the news that there's been a lot of cyber attacks. So West Point is very interested in that. How do we protect against cyber attacks? So since everything is digital, what happens if somebody attacks our digital world? You have to be able to protect it. So very important field. Andrea Tomas and Simon, she says, why do we have to program everything to teach a robot how to do something? Let's just show it. Let's interact with it. So that's what her group's working on. They show Simon tasks, they'll pour something, and then Simon will ask them questions. Can I do it like this? Can I do it like this? That's a lot easier, right, than writing programs? So that's one of the things she's working on. Ayanna Howard is also at Georgia Tech. She studies the impact of global warming on the Antarctic ice shelf with her little snow robots. So what does she have to do? She has to work in computer vision, fuzzy logic, neural networks. If you're mathematically inclined, that's a great field. Robin Murphy is also, I actually worked with her a little bit, and she founded the field of rescue robots. So it makes sense when something goes really wrong, like when 9/11 happened, she drove up there and volunteered her rescue robots, because why should we send more people in when it's a dangerous and dirty and scary environment when we can send robots in and see if there's anybody there to rescue or not? So very interesting field. She's volunteered her robots for lots of disasters now, and she works in artificial intelligence. Joy is a riot. She is one of the students at Georgia Tech. She started her first company before she even got to Georgia Tech. Her school had terrible website. So she taught herself web development in order to fix her school's website. And then the school wanted a company to work with, so she informed a company before she even got to Georgia Tech. And she's already started two or three companies while she was at Georgia Tech. She started a company for hair care. And she went to Zambia. She's a Rhodes Scholar, or she just finished her Rhodes Scholar. But before she did that, she went to Zambia this summer and taught women how to make apps. So trying to get more women, especially in the developing world, they're interested in how do we create apps to help our world and our environment. So she did that. Should be really interesting down the road too. Rosa Arriaga is a senior research scientist like me, but the Health Institute. She does a lot of work with autism and asthma. So how do we use technology to improve these conditions, especially long-term conditions too? So autism, we have a professor at Tech who has a couple of autistic kids, and sometimes when they're in a group environment, they blow up, and you don't know why, right? What was the trigger? So one of the things one of the students did in that institute was create a system that would record constantly what was going on in the classroom, and then if the kid blew up, the teacher would hit a button, and it would save, it would go back, because it was just constantly writing over the data, because that's a lot of data, But if the teacher hit a button, it would save then that chunk 5 minutes before. So you could analyze it and figure out what was the trigger? What caused the kid to blow up? Oh, I see now, it was this thing that happened. You know, it's a lot of interesting work that they're doing with kids with conditions. Mun Mun is working with analyzing social media. So you can actually, there's been some papers that show you can predict if somebody has postpartum depression based on what they're posting in social media. So think about if I can predict people's behavior, and actually a lot of people at Facebook actually do a lot of work in this, and they can tell you what countries are happier than other countries and what countries are probably going to have political turmoil just by monitoring what's going on. So that's a really big and growing area. Karen Liu does a lot of work with robotics, but also with video game companies. So she's trying to have realistic movement. You know, so how do we make, video games have gotten better and better about how people actually move. But so she studies how do people actually move, and then does physics-based simulations. So she's done a lot of interesting work. Jaquita, I worked with Jaquita. She's now a professor at Spelman. She got her Ph.D. from Georgia Tech in CS. She also used to do beauty competitions and was a singer. That she worked at IBM Research for a little bit. And Cecilia Aragon is actually a skilled aerobic pilot, but she developed interfaces to how do you handle when there's so much that's digital now, so much data, how do we deal with it? How do we visualize it? How do we understand it? So she works with large data sets, and she's interested in, again, how social media is changing scientific practice. So a lot of people are studying that intersection. I love this project. Did you guys see Up, the movie Up? Remember the dog collar, the dog talked? We joke that she's making the dog collar. So what she's doing, we have a blind PhD student at Georgia Tech who has a dog, assistive dog, and she loves dogs. So she wanted to do a project with him, and she said, what would you like your dog to be able to tell you? And he says, stairs. I get to stairs, I don't know if they go up or down. Can you imagine? I trip on stairs and I can see them. So imagine you get there and you don't know if I'm supposed to be doing this or that, right? He also said one time he was walking across campus and the dog stopped. He doesn't know why. He tells the command, the dog go forward, dog still stops. Forward, dog still stops. They go forward into wet concrete. So he said, "Hey, I can't do that, would be really nice. You know, the dog tell me. I just can't do what you want me to do. Let's do something else, okay?" So what they've done is create vests for the dogs and teach them to nose sensors on the vests that then have audio so that it can talk to the handler. So it's not quite the up collar, but she'll get there. She also did some really cool work with people with severe disabilities that have locked-in syndrome, with trying to be able to read their thoughts, basically, with electrodes and be able to figure out how to move cursors. And one of the first things that happened, there was a guy that had been locked in for years, and when he finally was able to communicate, the first thing he did was fire his caregiver. So you can imagine, right? I've been locked in, I can't communicate, and this guy is not really, or this caregiver is not really working for me, but I can't say anything about it. So being able to fire that caregiver and communicate, what a huge thing for that person. Carolina Hernandez is one of my students. She worked a lot with outreach. She's now a senior program manager at Microsoft, and she gets to travel all over the world. One of the cool things about Facebook is I can stay in touch with old students and see what she's doing. She's having a fabulous time. She goes to the Super Bowl. She does all sorts of fun stuff. So why should you care about computing? Well, one reason is there's a lot of jobs. It's kind of sad that we have so many jobs in computer science. The estimate is by 2020 we'll have 1.4 million jobs in computing, but only 400,000 people who are able to fill those jobs. And really, since I've been in computing, that's always been the case. We've always had more jobs in computing than we've had people to fill them, so we always import workers, H-1B visas. But that's somewhat of a shame. I mean, yeah, I'm glad that we bring people from all over the world, but I really would like more Americans to have these jobs too. So why shouldn't we? And one of the really scary things that a lot of people don't realize is that people talk about STEM. We need STEM. People have to do STEM. Computing jobs are 60% of the jobs in STEM. So there's some fields in STEM, like biology, where we have way more people than we need. Way more women, especially in biology. A lot of women go into biology thinking they're going to be doctors. And if they don't become doctors, a BS in biology gets you nothing. Sort of like my political science degree. So, you know, if you're thinking of biology, you think you might want to be a doctor, maybe think about minoring in computing or taking some computing classes at least. even if you don't get a minor, knowing something about computer science can make you stand out. So at Georgia Tech, we require everybody to take and pass a CS1 to graduate. And one of the international business students actually liked computer science course and decided to be a TA. She got way more interviews than all of her friends because companies said, you know something about computer science? We need that. So, you know, trumpet that fact that you know something about computer science. Take more courses because we want you guys to change the world. So there's lots of opportunity in computing. You can pair computing with any other field. There's so much that can be done with that. Medicine, there's tons of work you can do with medicine and computing. Law, one of my fellow PhD students actually went to law school and now is getting her PhD in computer science because she wants to do, you know, copyright law and law around computing. People also do, when I had my patent done, lawyers that know technology well enough to do patents is a big and lucrative field. Business, if you know business and computer science, every business needs computer science. So if you know something about business computer science, you're good. Science, all sciences now need computer science as a base. You know, you can't do a whole lot. Art, you can create with a computer. You can draw even on a computer. You can make music with computers. I mean, all music these days is computer processed. So if you can do that, you're way ahead of everybody. We have a project at Georgia Tech called EarSketch, which is where we teach kids how to program computers by writing programs to remix music. You know, and we had musicians come in and say, yeah, that's what we make music these days. We write algorithms to modify the music. So you're ahead. And the one of the good quotes from Alan Kay is, he was one of the people who invented the first personal computer, and he was working at Xerox PARC, and the Xerox, what is Xerox known for? Breaking down. Copiers, right? So the executives at Xerox were like, what do we do with this computer thing? How does it help us sell paper for copiers or make copies? He says, look, you know, and they kept saying to him, how do you predict the future? You know, what's going to be hot 5 years from now, 10 years from now? And he said, no, you got it wrong. The best way to predict the future is to invent it. And he invented the personal computer, and they didn't get it at Xerox. They didn't understand why that was important. So I want you guys, best way to predict the future is to invent it. What were you going to invent? Get out there and invent your future. You know, the future is here often, it's just not evenly distributed. So you're getting a chance in this camp to sort of see the future and to try to figure out what you might want to do with it. How are we doing on time? Can I want time for one video? Okay. Let's see if I can get out of this. Oops. So how many people have seen Google Glass? So one of the inventors of Google Glass is at Georgia Tech. I'm trying to figure out how I get out of this. Ah, there we go. And he created Google Glass because he wanted people to actually look at each other. If you go to a restaurant or anything these days, you'll see people sitting around all staring at their phones. So he said, we're all involved in our computers all the time anyway, but we're staring at them like this. What if they were here so I could not have to look down to do something else, but I'd still interact with you? So that was his whole notion behind Google Glass. I ride horses, so this is kind of fun. So augmented reality, which is what Google Glass is, I can see reality, but I'm adding something to it, is a real big and growing area. And probably will be in your future something you will be experiencing. You will have augmented reality. We kind of do a little bit with, you know, GPS. We can see traffic overlaid on stuff, but it's going to be in your vision. Some people I was with a few weeks ago were saying that they think augmented reality is the next really big thing. I'm really excited about this.
Percent of my vision is gone. I'm well past legally blind.
He's legally blind, he said.
You lose your timing in life. Everything takes you much longer. There are some places that you cannot go. There are some things
he's
that
not
you really
driving.
Cannot do. Where this would change my life is to give me the independence and the flexibility to go places I both want to go and need to go.
self-driving cars. They're started already, but they're not everywhere. You know, features here, it's not evenly distributed, but you will have self-driving cars in your lifetime. I think that's great, because by the time I can't drive, the car can drive for me. Yay! And then we won't have people, you know, planes now, people don't even realize, most planes are not being flown by the pilot most of the time. The computers are flying them. And they actually have a better record than the pilots do. Same thing with the self-driving cars. Most of the accidents with self-driving cars has been when the people are in charge, not the car. Though it can happen. When I was at General Motors long ago, they had some self-driving car technology. And of course, it was early on. And so it used to do things like try to dive at the concrete embankment. Yeah, wasn't so good. Robots really changing. I want one, but they're like $10,000 a pop. But that's what happened with computers. They were really expensive and they got really cheap. So you'll have robots in your lifetime that you can play with. I mean, there already are some. I have little dinosaur robots that I use with the kids. They love those. They pet the little robots and they sing. You can make the robots sing. They'll do jingle bells and other fun things. So we had kids programming robots. So robots are a big growing part. You're going to see lots of robotics in your lifetime. I mean, robots have been around for a long time. Being at General Motors Research Labs, they've been using robots for a long time, but those robots were stationary and they were in the factory. They were painting cars, they were welding things. What's different now is robots are out among us, and they might start looking like us somewhat, humanoid. If you've seen Osmo, the little kid in a spacesuit sort of looking robot that can walk, it can go up and down stairs. So what's cool about that is you learn a lot about how do people walk, and you can use that for other things like prosthetics. So prosthetics are a lot better than they used to be because they're taking some of that knowledge and putting it into those things. So those are just some of the areas that are big, cybersecurity, but that is part of what's neat about computer science is there's always something new, something interesting going on. Let me see, is there another one I want to show? Not that one. That one. Does anybody see Avatar?
I started writing the film in 1995, and it had all the characters in it and creatures and settings, but at the time, it turned out that it wasn't possible to do what I wanted to do.
So I don't know if you could hear that, but he's saying he started writing the movie in 1995, but the technology wasn't there. He couldn't do what he wanted to do.
Captures a technique where you try to capture the performance of an actor and translate it to a digital character. You put an actor in a suit with markers on the suit. We put you in a spatial volume using a lot of cameras all around to record the motions of all the markers. The computer is creating a real-time moving skeleton of you. From that skeleton, you now can drive a computer-generated character.
The intent is to capture the entire performance of the talent. We're recording tons of high-definition reference so that we can really get those subtle nuances.
So the thing that they did that was a really breakthrough was all the markers on their face so they could capture their emotions. If you go back and look at older things that they had done, like Polar Express, anybody see Polar Express? They look so weird. You know, their skin looks plastic. So that's partially because, you know, our skin, when you're trying to model skin, it's actually a lot more complex than you might think. Skin, the sunlight actually penetrates the first layers of skin, doesn't just bounce off. When it just bounces off, then it looks plastic. So that was fine for Toy Story. They were dolls, right? They're supposed to be plastic. But when you're trying to humans, it doesn't work so well. So this was an attempt to do human-like things with human-like emotions. And so they did all these little dots to capture their facial expressions and then map those onto the 3D model. So doing work with, you know, movies require lots of work with computers. Even now, if you're watching sports at all, right? Football, basketball, whatever, they're showing you lines that are really not there, you know, and they're showing you how the trajectory of things were. That's all computer generated. That's all computer graphics. So your world is all based in computing. So you have the way that you guys live, work, play, everything you do is based in computing. So it's better for you to know how to harness that than not. questions? Yeah. You're welcome. Yeah. So one of the problems when you're developing a car is sheet metal doesn't do what clay can do. So they can design all sorts of stuff out of clay they can't make out of sheet metal. So that was one of the tricky parts, was going, okay, yeah, you want this thing, but can we make that out of sheet metal? Will it even bend that way? So actually, I was working with the physicists who were doing molecule simulations to decide whether the metal could even bend that way. And they had a whole room full of parts where they would try it, and there'd be a big hole in the middle of the door because the sheet metal didn't flow that way. They also want to know, can they make it cheap enough? So you can design something really fancy, but it would require several hits, is what they call it, to put like creases. You know, the crease doesn't happen automatically. You have to hit it with something. So in order to do all those different things, you got to do more and more hits to the metal. That puts more stress on the metal. Does the metal rip? Does it tear? Does it get too thin? So simulations, being able to simulate it, because a hardened steel die, when they make the die that they put the sheet metal in to stamp it, they use that thing thousands of times, right? So it's got to be really, really hard to not wear down over time. One hardened steel die costs $10,000 to do. So you don't want to do one of those if you're not sure it's going to work. So they did a lot of work with computer simulation to decide, is that even going to work? Yeah, they were certainly limited by what are the materials, what does it cost? No, it sounds like I never knew what I wanted to do when I grew up, doesn't it? You know, life does that to you. You think you're going one direction and, this other opportunity presents itself. So, you know, I started at General Motors Research Labs. I like 3D graphics. I took a master's level class in 3D graphics. I thought it was fun. So I liked that when I started off. But I also liked AI. So when I had the opportunity to go to Bell Communications Research, and they would send you for your master's for free, some companies would make you sign a two-year agreement or X-year agreement. They didn't do that. They didn't even want you back if you didn't finish in a year. You didn't have to pay them back. You didn't have to do anything, but you had to finish in a year. So some of it was what opportunities I had kind of drove which direction I was going at times. But, you know, that's one of the things I like about computer science. There's so many different things you can do. I love the medical stuff. It was really fun. But I also love the education stuff. I think it's really interesting. So you can find so many interesting problems to work on. That's what I think is neat. And to contrast it, being from Detroit, everybody in Detroit practically works in the car industry. My dad was a low-level manager at a stamping plant. So part comes down, you do something to it. Part comes down, do the same thing to it. Part comes down, do the same thing to it. Hated his job, so boring. And so one of the things I realized is I did not want a boring job like that. I wanted a job where it was interesting, that I thought I was doing something worthwhile, that I, you know, was learning something. So some of it was driven by that I want a job where I'm learning. I always want to learn, do something different, help people. Scary, isn't it?
But what I thought was really interesting was you wound up being somebody that was so gifted in the computing field, but it wasn't your immediate choice for a major right out of high school. And as a professor, I've seen that a lot too. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure there's some students who maybe would be very gifted, but never are fortunate enough to discover it. So, I mean, given how evidently valuable computing is, I'm curious if you have any theories as to why the numbers aren't higher.
Yeah.
Students coming out of high school, and more specifically, why they aren't higher for females.
So 80% of college freshmen say they have no idea what computer science is. So why would you major in it if you don't even know what it is? And for women, especially college-bound women, they tend to associate with negative stereotypes. So they're not interested because they don't think it's for them. Men are much more interested, college-bound men are much more interested in computing as a career and think it's a good career for someone like them. So 70-some percent of, there was a WGBH study with the ACM. So some 70% of males said computing jobs were a good or very good choice for someone like them. Only 22% of women did. So that's a huge gap. And really, really the three factors to overcoming that are exposure. You got to get women exposed to computing earlier, or anybody who might be good at it who doesn't know what it is and doesn't think they'd be interested. So getting them earlier exposed, encouraging them to continue. Encouragement trumps ability for women. So for men, encouragement and ability are about equally predictive. For women, encouragement is more important than ability. So having somebody who can encourage them, especially dads for women. I don't know if it's true for you guys, but science says that men are important for girls choosing a non-traditionally female field. If your dads are for it, you're more likely to be willing to do it because you're already facing barriers. People are already telling you, wait, that's not for you. So if you can get your dads behind you, that's a really good thing. I used to do workshops with Girl Scouts, and I'd take them, and the dads would take the daughters camping, and we would do robotics with the girls, and I'd bring Georgia Tech girls, and the dads would go, hey, my son would love this. And I'm like, yeah, your daughter's enjoying it too. Let's focus on her. She's here. You know, so some of that is our society believes this is male. In Malaysia, computer science is over 50% female. And when you tell Malaysian women that in the West it's considered male, they're like, what about this as male? It's indoor, it's not heavy lifting, it's not dirty, it's not dangerous. We think of it as like sewing. So what part of it is male? Which makes a lot of sense, right? It's none of those things, yeah, okay. And some of those early computers were hired because they thought women were good at detail and good at programming. Mid-80s.
Yeah. As someone who's lived through that, do you have sort of a visceral sense of what changed from mid-80s
Yeah.
Now?
I think the biggest challenge is, so when I was going for computer science, it was over 40% female in my classrooms and things, so I didn't feel odd at all. It was, you know, nearly half. It was a high percentage of female. And one of the things that happened, now remember early on, you had to type, and that was a female thing, not a male thing. So the men at Xerox PARC, for example, when they were shown the first computer, were like, well, we wouldn't touch that. That would be for our secretaries because we don't type. So that's one of the things the guys had to overcome was that they had to learn how to type. That was a stereotypically female job. But women, so a lot of early women working with computers, women did work with computers a lot early. They were data punch operators or, you know, they did the typing part because men didn't do the typing part. But eventually men got over that and did the typing. So I think a lot of things that happened, so when I first started working with computers weren't even up all the time. General Motors Research Labs used to have a sign, how long has the computer been up this week? So computing was not a 80-hour a week job, it was a 40-hour a week job because the computer wasn't even up all the time, you know, so we weren't expected to work long hours, or it was a nice job. But when the startup culture started in the 80s with the personal computer, then it became, I track a lot of the maleization of the field to that, because the startup culture is very male. High risk, high reward, lots of hours. So that's part of what gave computer science this rep of you have to work lots of hours. You know, also because the computer time, some of the people like that were working with computers early on, you could only get hours in the middle of the night, right? Because so people worked, stayed up late, that also impacted it. But I also think it was the personal computer and people targeting boys for making games. Yeah, definitely. You know, you see it in the pop culture, you know, the geek culture, the nerd, you know, stereotype became very prevalent in the 80s. You know, what is that? Computer scientists. Oh, they're the people who know pi to the whatever digit and live in little cubicles in their parents' basement or whatever, you know, and never talk to people. And I've had that reaction from people. You know, I've had people say to me, oh, you can't be a computer scientist. You know, you don't look like one. You were a cheerleader? What? You know, you know, the guys that I went to high school with. When I came back at one of my reunions, they went, oh my God, you were a cheerleader and you're in computer science? How the heck? You know, you can't be a computer scientist, what? You know, that just blew their minds, right? I've been out with people who, you know, I was telling someone a story. I was out when my husband was a grad student at Michigan, and we went out to dinner with another grad student and his wife. We're talking, having a good time. And then the conversation moved to computers, and I said something and her face dropped. Oh my God, you're one of them. She said, I thought you were normal. Like, I can pass for normal, usually. You know, but that reaction of you can't be in computer science, you don't fit my stereotype, you know, that does a lot to people. people, young women especially, are affected by the social norms. And I've seen my daughter. She's good at math. She gets an A in math all the time. And she'll say, I'm bad at math. What do you mean you're bad at math? You get an A in math all the time. It's not my best subject. She's very good at math. She wanted to be a scientist when she was a little kid. She was always doing experiments. I'd find weird things with fungus growing them all over, you know, the house. But, you know, some of that got drummed out of her over time because it's not socially acceptable. You know, so you do see some of that happen to people, which is a shame, you know? Do cool stuff. One of the things I like about computer science is you can work part-time, you can work from home. I worked, once I had my kids, I worked part-time. Best of both worlds. Kids are in daycare, I'm working some, but I get to play with them when I want to. I can go on field trips, I can do everything. So why wouldn't you want to be a computer science if you're a young woman who wants a family and wants extra time? It's a great job for that. So some of it, I think, is society, culture, yes. One thing, women, girls and boys at the same level, the girl thinks she's here and the boy thinks he's here. This is scientifically based, okay? So people at the same level, the boy will at least pretend he's here and the girl will think she's down here. So this is a problem. Girls are usually not as interested in the computer younger like boys do. Some boys just get excited about it. They love it as a thing. They just want to know all about it. They want to learn everything they can. They get kind of maniac about stuff. Women often don't do that. Women often think computers as tools. It's an interesting tool. Let me do what I want to do. So women often do come to it later. They often get what they call imposter syndrome. I don't belong. They all know this. They don't all know it. Half the time they're lying, you know, but even if they do know it, so what? You can learn it too, right? Just because you're coming to it later. I mean, if you've taken up a sport that other people did before, yeah, of course you're not as good as them, but you can learn. And sometimes you'll get better than people who have done it for years. But it takes work, of course. But yes, that is a problem, that boys do get attracted earlier. They often get attracted because they play computer games. They think it's really cool. They want to learn all they can about it. And girls often don't treat it that way. Yeah. Studies have often shown that the girls who leave computer science in undergrad actually have better grades than the boys who stay. So often when a girl doesn't get a good grade, she says, I can't learn this. When a boy doesn't get a good grade, he blames the teacher. It's not my fault. Teacher is no good. You know, so don't take it on yourself. You know, if you're not having success with something, get a better teacher, get a better class, do something different. Don't give up just because something seems hard either. Somebody was saying that this can be frustrating. I said, frustration's good. It means you're learning something. If you're not frustrated, you're probably not learning anything. I mean, I get frustrated when I ride, when I'm working on a new skill, when I ride, everything else falls apart. Oh, my heels aren't down. Oh crap, what am I doing now? Because I'm doing something new. But when you master it, you feel great. But it's frustrating to learn, sure. It's always frustrating to learn.
You know, we find that many of our female students actually have a competitive edge with getting internships because they're good listeners, they're good collaborators.
And companies want more women. So.
And with a renewed interest in user experience design, it brings in a variety of skills in aesthetics and psychology and visual design.
Yep. No, I think we need everybody. I'm not trying to say we shouldn't have men in computer science either. I think we need men in computer science, but it shouldn't be, we are way too skewed male in computer science. We are as skewed, So of AP exams, computer science is the most male. Do you know what the most female is? Art. But there's more men taking studio art than there are women taking computer science. So, yes.
In a class with both boys and girls, the tendency is for the boys to be very aggressive, answer questions, ask more questions.
Yep.
What kind of advice would you
give? I think I'm here.
What kind of advice would you give to young girls?
So, one advice to professors is don't allow that. Don't allow the boys to take over. Don't allow the boys to yell things out. One good lesson I learned from somebody who we have a center that's about teaching is they say, when you're going to ask a question, tell everybody you're going to count to 10 before you pick anybody. Or have an app that has everybody's name and do it random. Pick on people randomly, right? And have them stand up. I know you're all going, I don't want to know. That's okay. Yes, but you do want to get called on different times. But don't let the boys yell things out. Don't let them lord it over. You get boys, you know, part of where that nerd and geek image comes from is you get guys like that in computer science. I saw them when I was an undergrad. They weren't the majority by any means, but there are guys who are like, well, the 6502 chip, you know, did it this way. And everybody else is like, what? You know, they're trying to show off what they know. And so if you get somebody in your classes that does that, say, hey, I'm really glad you're excited about this, but you know what? Let's talk about it after class. You know, shut them down. Don't let them show off all their knowledge in class. Do lots of pair or group activities, because you know what? They'll find out that the guy next to him who's raising hand all the time really doesn't know what he's talking about. You know, when you actually sit and work with him, like, you didn't, okay, you don't get that. So. So do lots of things like that. Don't let people, that is one of the problems in computer science classrooms, is you'll get the boys who will yell things out or raise hands and try to lord it over everybody else, but don't let them do that. And encourage the women, you know, try to call on people randomly, or do group work. Less terrifying. You saw how they all went, don't call on us randomly. But if I had you all in groups and I said, okay, I'm gonna give you 5 minutes to work on this, now I'm gonna ask a team to talk about it, that'd be less scary, right? Women often don't want to raise their hand until they're sure they have the answer. Guys will put their hand up before they even thought about it. So another approach is to say, I'm not going to call anybody until 10 seconds go by, and then go, nobody hand up till now. Now the girls had a chance to think about it. Okay, I'm right. I'll put my hand up. The boys, they're putting their hands up without even thinking about it, be like, oh, yeah, maybe I should think about it. Oh, that's a tricky one. You know, ideally both. So at Georgia Tech, we have students who do a lot of internships. They do a lot of company stuff, and they learn a lot from that. But it's also great to get involved in research, especially if you think you might want to go on at all. So if you can do both, and we have students who do both. Most of my students are gone in the summer doing internships, and then they'll do research with me during the school year. So yeah, if you're at all interested in research, get a head start. By all means, try it and find out. Don't be afraid. The biggest mistake I see women and everybody make in college is they're afraid to get help. They're afraid to go talk to the professor. The professors are in their office hours, half the time bored to death because nobody shows up. I mean, they're not really bored, they're doing other work. But, you know, they kind of would like it to help students. It's the reason they go into being a professor, is they want to help people. And nobody shows up until 2 minutes before something's due. And then you have a line out the door, right? So don't be afraid to go talk to your professors. And professors, encourage your female students. That's the number one thing you can do as a professor. It's cheap. You have any females in your class, encourage them. Talk to them. Ask them what their career goals are. Try to steer them in places. Encourage them. Let them know how they're doing. Let them know they're doing well. They're not thinking they are. You know, so tell them they're doing well. Yeah, I have had high school students work with me. I don't know if you guys do high school interns at all. Not too many. But you know what? You never know if you don't ask. So I get, every year, I get a bunch of teachers. Since I teach teachers, a bunch of the high school teachers will contact me to say, hey, are there any internships opportunities? And one of the things I'll do is try to connect them to local businesses as well. So there are certainly high school students in our area that have done internships with me. Because they'll often work for free because it looks good on their resume. So I'll give them a chance. I'll be like, hey, make, you know, and, you know, go ahead and if you find somebody's work interesting, go introduce yourself. Say, hey, what do you need done? Is there some task I could do? I could make a video. I could do social networking. Most of us older folks are not as good with social networking skills as you guys are. So, you know, you can say, hey, I can create a site for you. I can create a website for you. I can do Twitter feed for you. I can do whatever. So find a need and fill it. But don't be afraid to put yourself out there to do that. It depends. I certainly have professors at Tech who will not talk to students because they can't even get undergrads to do work. They don't want to deal with high school students. But I've had some great high school students, and I've had people who will work with them. So try.
And Marla, how skilled are they in computer science?
Not necessarily all that skilled. Depends what I want them to do. So I have at the moment five high school students working with me on the ebook stuff that I'm doing. So they're creating videos. Some of them are creating videos to explain computing concepts. Some of them are creating videos to solve problems. So that's something that's not too hard to do, is make a video. And especially they're kids that have already taken computer science, AP computer science, so they know the concepts I'm trying to get people to teach. And what's good about that is people learn better if you can build on what you already know. Now, to you guys, I'm unimaginably old, you know, because I'm way big age gap here. So like when I run summer camps, it's always kind of funny. Because I'll go, like I did with you guys, I'll come kneel down next to people in summer camps or whatever and talk to them. And you can see the little kids going, who's this lady? What is she doing? You know, and I'll try to help them sometimes. They'll have their hands up and I'll go try to help them. They're like, no, I'm working on this. Like, yeah, I wrote that. But, you know, they can't identify with me. So I hire high school students to work with them, right? Yeah, because that's the age level they can adapt, they can understand. So near peer works well, getting somebody near their age. And you guys should consider that when you guys go back. Now that you've learned all this summer, how many of you have like a coding club or something at your school? Or cool. But you could also take what you've learned and try it with middle school students. You are like gods to middle school students. You want to feel good about yourself? You know, you were like, wow. I think the oldest I ever felt was when I was in my 20s. And I was playing at a playground, and a bunch of little kids came to me. Wow, how old are you? Are you in college? You know, but that little hero worship is really cute, right? So you can be gods to people in your neighborhood, and they can look up to you. No. And we admit, we don't care what your major is when we admit. So they don't really look at your major and what you're, you know, they look at your, they want to see that you're academically, that you've, whatever your school offers, that you've challenged yourself academically. So one of the mistakes I see people make is like, I want to have a really high GPA, so I'm going to take all easy classes. Yeah, no, that's not going to work. Whatever your school offers that's hard, they want to see you took it. You know, and they want to see that you're well-rounded too. They don't want to see that you just did one thing, you know, and never did anything else. So they do want to see that you're well-rounded, that you've done other things. And if you don't get into Georgia Tech right away, this is the biggest secret, I think, in the college world, is too many people think, oh, if I don't go to the school I really want to right away as a freshman, that's it. You know, we have a bigger junior and senior class than we have freshman and sophomore class. So we encourage people to go elsewhere for 2 years, often cheaper. And you don't have to take those weeder classes where they're trying to get rid of people. You know, with all these people at Georgia Tech, you can take them somewhere else and then transfer in. It doesn't matter where you start, it matters where you graduate from. So wherever you're going, think of that. I know that we were talking that FIU also has a lot of people to transfer in. So you're not stuck any place you start. What are some of the what? Well, they know how to do social media better than I do. So yeah, I've certainly used them for that. I've certainly used them to make videos and make concepts. They're good at explaining things that a high school student, I have to think about it sometimes, right? The way that I introduce topics, I have to sometimes say, wait a minute, you guys weren't born when I used that reference. Okay, let me think again, you know? Because, you know, we're talking about things from our life. So I've talked about movies where I went, okay, wait a minute, what year was that movie? Okay, nope, it's not gonna work. So you can try things that are a lot closer to you. Like anybody watch Big Bang Theory? You know, they had this whole friendship algorithm at one point. I'm like, And I actually, I'm an AP reader, so I go grade the AP exams. I graded with the woman who taught Sheldon computer science. He's actually not very good at computer science, but he's a theater major. So he was an actor, right? He's acting like a geek. He's not, it wasn't a geek. So I have problems with that show in that it enforces negative geeky images, but it's also funny at times. So it's one of those things where you're like, yeah, everybody's got to be geeky and nerdy. That's not the way it really is. Yeah. Yes. Well, and that came through the last like 10 years. There have been people who embrace the geekiness, but it scares people away too sometimes. So my son, my husband and I are both in computer science. No, you know, so my son liked computer science, and one of his female friends said, Matthew would be okay, except he tells everyone he's a geek. Nobody would know if he wasn't telling them all the time. What's funny about that? She majored in computer science at Georgia Tech. But she was saying, you shouldn't tell people you're a geek, right? Even though she now works at Google. I helped her get her job, too. It's kind of funny. So, yeah, you have to be careful of that. Some people love it. Some people don't. So I would not push the geeky image because it doesn't appeal to everybody. I would, you know, what I tell my students who work my summer camps is we don't talk about the negative stereotypes. We just blast them. We show how much fun, how creative, how social computing is. So we don't even discuss the negative stereotypes. We just counter them and say, look, this is so cool. I mean, it blows my mind that high school students say that computer science is not relevant to their lives. What are you talking about? You walk around with a cell phone. I have to pry them from my kids' hands. We were on walking on a volcano in Hawaii. It's all jumbled and there's steam rising and they're all on their cell phones texting. I'm like, you give me those. You do not need those right now. You know, how can you say computer science is not relevant to your life when you're constantly, my daughter's constantly, look at this kitten, isn't it cute? Yes, this is why we spend so much money doing computer science, so you can watch cat videos, you know. But, you know, that's, how can you say that's not relevant? You use it all the time. You're constantly on Twitter, you know, Tumblr, you're constantly doing stuff with your friends, you're texting all the time. How can you say that's not relevant to your life? Doesn't make sense to me. Ooh, nice question. So when I was at Wayne State, and I was double majoring, political science, computer science, and I got to see, I had this great class, Law is Literature, where we read First Amendment cases, and I said, ooh, I want to be a Supreme Court judge. They don't let you just do that. So I went, maybe I have to rethink this. I don't just get to be a Supreme Court judge. That's really cool. I could do First Amendment cases. That would be fun. I said, and I went on a co-op, so I went and worked in computer science. And I said, hey, this is fun too. I can see myself doing this. And I took a couple of master's level courses and yeah, there's more to learn. Cool, AI, how do I make computers act intelligent when they're really stupid? That's really cool. So I could see stuff that I thought was really interesting that would keep me captured and interested. Even though law school is also interesting, I'm not saying you can't go into law school, but I thought this way looks good. Yeah. It varies. I'd say you're probably more likely to get at a small company when you're in high school than a big company. So like Google, I don't think hires a lot of high school interns. But if you can get a Google internship, it's a lot of fun. Google's a crazy place. They have masseuses. They have all the food you want. They bring their dogs to work. It's like, what? It's a crazy place. It's really cool. I've been there a couple of times. They fund one of my projects. So, you know, really neat environment to work in. But yeah, for high school students, you're probably better off trying to so some of you do web development and you're learning web development in this classes. A lot of people need web stuff done and they really don't know anything about it. So if you can volunteer to work for somebody near you or local company who just needs somebody to try to create a web thing, and if it doesn't work, that's okay. They didn't spend any money on it. That's probably the easiest way to get in. So my undergrads get paid. People in computer science degrees, by the time they're sophomores, they go to Google, they go to whatever, and they get paid. So unlike a lot of other fields, like my daughter's a psychology major, she doesn't get paid for anything. Yeah. Or I had a niece who was a occupational therapist. Yeah, she had to do an internship where she didn't even get paid to do her internship. I mean, so it really does vary by career, but computer science, you get paid pretty quickly. And if you were in high school, if you volunteered at a company for a little bit and you proved your worth, they probably would pay you eventually. So you're likely to get paid a lot quicker, and get paid pretty well too often. So computer science at Georgia Tech was both the highest starting salary of any grads as well as the highest lowest. So our lowest starting salary was higher than anybody else. And our highest was six figures. So, and this is people just out of college. And it's been that way for years. When I graduated, my mom was a nurse. She'd gone back to school and got a nursing degree. And nurses work hard. And when I graduated from college and I got offers, she went, "What? I've been working as a nurse for how many years? And it's hard work, and you're going to get paid what? You know, for not having to do any heavy lifting or clean up crap, right?" So, yeah, computer science pays well. It's one of the things I like about it, too. And we get to play with cool toys.
What stands out in a person? Like, when you see their resume, what are the things that you tend to look for?
Ooh. Well, it depends what I'm looking to, who I'm trying to hire. So when I do outreach sort of things, I'm looking for somebody who's done some interesting things, who's volunteered, who's done something academic, too. You know, if you've gotten any sort of awards, that stands out. So my daughter's right now I have a 17-year-old as well as a 20-year-old and a 23-year-old. My 17-year-old right now is the Governor's Honors Program, which is a 4-week summer camp paid for by the state of Georgia, and it's at a college campus. And so that would really stand out on a resume if you're a Governor's Honors Program. So if somebody who gets a special award, that stands out. But just being, it also helps if you're friendly, outgoing. If I get references that say, "Hey, you gotta hire this person. This person works hard, they're friendly, they're outgoing, they're articulate." You're like, "Yeah, okay, I'll hire him." But good questions.
Any other questions? Time for one or two more.
I'll ask you guys a question. All right, stand up if you liked playing in Scratch. All right, good. Sit down if you are thinking of a career that doesn't involve computing at all. Yeah, right, you're smart. You knew that. I was gonna say all careers involve computing. Good. Let me think one more thing. Stay standing if you want to do something interesting in your life. Yeah, you're all smart. Well, all right, I'm not going to make you do too much more. This is one of the games I often play at my camps to talk about Booleans, things that are true or false. We'll do a guess who game, and I'll have you write down like four things, like looking around you guys, like maybe who's wearing, are you wearing jeans, yes or no? Are you wearing, however many wearing glasses? Are you wearing a necklace, yes or no? So kind of try, and I'll have you write down something about yourself that's interesting that people wouldn't know about you, like I ride horses and jump things over obstacles. And then we'll play a guess who game, and I'll take all the cards and mix them up and say, we're looking for the person who's sung professionally, and then everybody stand up, and then, okay, if this applies to you, stay standing, otherwise sit down. So I'll say, hey, if you're wearing jeans, stay standing, otherwise sit down. And we get to the end and we say, hey, those are all conditionals. The person who all those things were true for is the person still standing. So you ever played Guess Who game when you guys were littler? Yeah, yes. See, a lot of computer science concepts you already know because they're part of normal life, like conditionals. Like if it's raining, I'm going to bring an umbrella. So if it's not raining, what do I do?
Bring an umbrella.
I don't bring the umbrella, right? So that's conditional or loops. Everybody ever get an earworm? Get a song stuck in your head, you know, and it just loops and loops and loops. Yeah, that's repetition. We do that all the time in computer science. We don't try to get the earworms in your head, but we use repetition, right? Because we don't have to explain the same thing over and over again. So a lot of computing concepts you already know, so, and others you'll learn. All right, you can sit down. Thank you. Thank you all. Too. Thanks for inviting me. Go create cool things. Oh, you're welcome.
You know, I'm a native at Ann Arbor myself.
Ah!
And a U of M graduate.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Where did you grow up in Michigan?
Okay. I was born in the Thumb, and I grew up in Sterling Heights.
Okay, great. Yeah. Ann Arbor for 21 years.
Great city.
Yep.
Awesome. Hi. We met.